We are in unprecedented times with the coronavirus going around, and I hope that as you watch this show, you have peace and comfort, knowing that God is in control. We want to do everything we can to continue on with our lives, even as we're playing it safe and doing what the president has suggested. My guest today is Al LeMay, Yamhill County Republican Chairman or Vice Chair, and we're going to be just talking a little bit about where our county's at, and just continue to keep you informed because there is an election coming up. So, Al, thanks.
Yeah, thanks for having me on. As you said, this is definitely an unprecedented time that we're facing, not just locally here, but across the nation and across the world. So,
yeah,
we'll see how we can do our small part here in Yamhill County to help folks out. So,
yeah. The idea is that according to the president, and just like colds and flus go around, you know. This one particular happens to be particularly active, so they're assuming everybody's going to get it, or most people are going to get it. But if they have the hospitals not packed, jam-packed, and we just keep our social distancing, and you know, it'll just kind of be a slower process, and people who will need their respirators will get the respirators in their care.
I think, you know, some of the guidelines that they put forth are good to put into practice, especially if you're in one of the high-risk categories, children, elderly, if you have already have a condition. We want to keep those individuals safe as possible, and by doing some of the things we're doing now, hopefully we're slowing that transmission rate to those people, because, you know, that's one of the core values of not just our political party, but I think of a lot of people. We fight for that life. We want to save all the lives that we can, you know, whether they're young, middle-aged, or old. So.
Yep. You know, and as Christians, too, that a lot of people in the Republican Party, you know, believe this, too, is the power of prayer. And Christ came to give life and life more abundantly. And so it's not his plan for anybody to die through this. That's the enemy's plan. And so, you know, we need to, you know, this time when we're not as active out in public, you know, use that time to connect with God in a deeper way. So,
yeah, it is a good opportunity to, again, reach into your family units, you know, your relatives that are there with you, and create deeper bonds with them. Find out more about what your children are interested in doing. Not just taking the cursory day-by-day things, you know, and maybe the, you know, while they love baseball or want to play sports or something, but connect to them on a different level. You know, one where we can emulate what the church was supposed to be. The church is not a set of buildings. So we don't, you know, we don't need that, you know, to be a church. We need the people. We need the bodies. And so that's why we say the body of Christ is not a building, but it's the people that make up that body.
Yeah. So. And I've noticed through this, the who we are comes out. Are we faithful, fearful? And I think everybody, including myself, has gone through that bit of fear. And especially, you know, when I went to the grocery stores and saw at one of the stores that the everything was like halfway empty, halfway full. I guess in this way, you look at the cup was half full. Empty in this case, because it was really eerie. But it kind of, very strange.
It's very strange. While we don't want to cause panics and things like that, you know, it is kind of strange when you go in and you don't see paper products on all the shelves, you know, and you wonder why, I wonder what's with all the missing paper products or all the cleaning supplies that have been cleaned out for some reason. We want people to try to be as normal as possible through this, you know, even though they may have to stay at home a little bit more than they're usually staying at home, do their jobs or what type of work they do. But we want to make sure that they don't, you know, run and hoard things. And then like I say, some of those folks that aren't able to make it to the store all the time, you know, like I said, if you're in one of the high risk categories, you know, they're the ones visiting the store and finding nothing. Mm-hmm. And or people that are on fixed incomes, you know, mm-hmm. things like that, they hit the store and next thing you know, they're even able to buy their own supplies. Mm-hmm. You know, they're going to be the people that can't really shop, you know, mm-hmm. 3-6 months, you know, down the line, because that's, you know, given their circumstances, that's where they're at.
Yeah.
And so it's prudent upon us to be judicious about when we do go shopping, mm-hmm. that we don't need, you know, 3 months supply of toilet paper or, you know, or of you know, hamburger or something like this to get by. Mm-hmm. You know, leave a little for others, mm-hmm. there, you
yeah.
know, so that we can, you know, kind of pull everybody up,
yeah.
you know,
yeah.
at the same time.
Yeah, you know, so. But that's good advice. Are you a prepper? Would you consider yourself a prepper?
I wouldn't say I was a prepper in the sense, but yeah, we do have, you know, some things
yeah.
that are,
yeah.
you know, won't run out,
uh-huh.
but I think it's more of a common sense thing.
Uh-huh.
You know, there's people that hunt, and so they probably aren't going to run out of food, you know.
Uh-huh.
There's other folks that don't like to hunt, so they're mm-hmm. it's going to be a little bit harder for them. There's folks that like to grow their own food, you know, have their own gardens and things like that, that do their own canning, especially here mm-hmm. in a rural type county.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think that, you know, there's too many, you know, you know, folks out there that are probably going to be, you know, preppers in the sense that, you know, I could hunker down in my little home for 1 year with
yeah.
my water supply uh-huh. and MREs or
yeah.
something, and get by with no social contact or
yeah.
something.
Yeah.
So, like I said, I think it's just important for people to try, you know, we want to say try to live your life as normal uh-huh. as possible, but at the same time, you're giving these opportunities to share and explore the love that you could actually, that Christ has set forth for mm-hmm. all to share.
Yeah.
For all those in the community.
Yeah.
So
I would like to encourage people to look at their loved ones in the home, that we've been so busy as a society, just going to games, working late, you know, going here, going there, just running around like crazy. And enjoy the time and, you know, play baseball with your kids or talk to your spouse and listen to your spouse. You know, there's yeah. a lot of times we're just talking past each other, you know, as
yep.
married couples. And my yep. husband and I, we've had some interesting talks
yeah.
lately. And first we were kind of fighting, and now we're getting along better than ever,
yeah.
you know, because we had to work through some things.
Yeah, and I think, it, like you say, it gives, you know, you see a lot of different things happening, you know. You could say, you know, while someone's maybe true nature might come through in these situations, you know, we would hope that, you know, there is that reconnection, you know, for some folks.
Yeah.
You know, you hate to say like, well, maybe they hit the reset button or something like this. You know, it's, I think they, you know, like you say, you know, it might be uncomfortable at first, you know, because like I say, you're not in that mode
uh-huh.
all the time. But this is, you know, think of it as an opportunity and
yeah.
a blessing for you to, you know, like you say, especially with your kids,
yeah.
because this is something that they may never see again uh-huh. or they may have to live with for a long time.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's, you know, is it going to be similar to those that have the stories that come out of the Great Depression?
Right.
You know,
yeah.
So.
And forgive, you know what, be the first to forgive. If you're caught in the middle of a spat or whatever, and you're, you know, the other yeah. person in your life, you know, was a jerk, you know what, just forgive them. They're probably in fear, going through a hard time. So
yeah.
you know, connect with God, you know, carry the faith. You know, there's nothing that's ever going to happen to anybody as long as they're in prayer that God isn't going to allow to happen. And so if it's my turn to die, you know, if God appointed me to die, you know, in 2 weeks from the coronavirus, then God appointed me to die in 2 weeks, you know.
Yeah.
so I go to heaven. I mean, that's,
yeah.
you know,
I mean,
right?
You know, yeah, as a Christian, you would want,
but
Jesus doesn't
yeah.
want one to not lose.
Yeah, he says, fear not, you know,
yeah.
I am with you. I feel compelled to say, the Bible talks about whether this is the time, you know, the last days or not.
Yeah.
The Bible talks about just horrendous stuff happening in the last day, you know, famines, you know, running out of food. So there will be this. You know, I have a feeling that right now we're kind of like in this, what do you call it? It's a test. It's to build, it's like, you know, going to the gym and working out for the big event. I feel like the big event is upon us, but that right now we're being like, it's like a slow test to get us to walk in faith, to love God first, love our families, you know, value life, you know, and quit, you know, feeling like as Americans we have to have all this luxurious items, because those are all blessings. Those aren't anything we need. We don't need a boat. We don't need, you know, we need shelter, oxygen, you know, food, water, you know, and right now that's what a lot of us have right now. You know, a lot of us aren't able to go out and do certain things that we would like to do. Yeah. But anyway, pass the test and move on. And
Yeah. Hopefully, like you say, this changes people's lives for the better.
Mm-hmm.
We know there'll still be some sad stories that come from this, but you know, and those that may pass from the virus or other conditions or something like this, we need, you know, we would only, you know, we're not going to be the ones that really bring them comfort, you know, like you say, through prayer and through God's grace and mercy is where their comfort's going to come from.
Yeah. So, you know, and I will also expect to see, you know, miracles, you know. I expect that there's, in fact, I've heard a couple already, just really cool things that have happened, you know, but, you know, that, you know, don't discount prayer. Don't discount the fact that, Jesus Christ was the same yesterday, today, and forever. You know, He healed yesterday, He'll heal today, He'll heal tomorrow. You know, according to our faith. We need to. That's the first thing. If me or my husband wind up, you know, or kids, I'm on my face. You know, I'm praying. That's my plan B. Plan one is to stay away from it. Plan B is to is to pray.
I think plan A is to pray.
And okay.
That
there we
will
go.
Lead you to, you know, because then I believe then you'll be prompted to do what is right and lead you to, you know, should you, you know, I can visit that person or can't visit that person because of these reasons.
God has his check, gives you a check in the start. Hey, stay away. You know, it's just not a good time.
So.
Another thing, okay, talking about, we're talking about real life issues.
Yeah.
Okay, as Republicans, I'm so proud that our president called for a National Day of Prayer.
Yeah. I mean, if it's not a great segue, right? We're talking about prayer, and here you go. Donald Trump says, you know what? That's what we need. And, you know, honestly, you know, it's like maybe you should have one of these declarations every day for everybody, you know? Because I think when you start to put the Lord first in your life and you start to think beyond where you're at right now, you stop seeing these selfish motives of individuals, you know, both, you know, as you know, congressmen or something like this, or within your own small community. You start to see people helping others, you know, and you wonder, wow, what's going on with that? And usually what happens is people say, oh, I want to be involved in that. I want, you know, and that kind of feeds on itself. So, like, you know, like we say, plan A, you know, if you're already a prayerful person, then this fits right in with what you're doing, right?
And if you're not,
this is a great way to start, start, you know, by saying, let's just pray for our leaders, make sure they, you know, even if I don't want to say, you know, if, even if you're not a believer, but, you know, seek out someone that maybe is and ask them about why prayer is so powerful in people's lives. And then you might have, you know, but on a National Day of Prayer, you know, having all those people at a specific time asking, you know, the Lord's comfort and guidance and things like this for even you know, Nancy Pelosi or Chuck Schumer, you know.
Well, pray for our enemies.
It's what we're called to do. I can't imagine a better idea.
I heard There's a couple of things I heard that were interesting. I heard that a rabbi, it's funny because, a few weeks ago, I was just, as this was all getting started, I was thinking, you know, our president needs to call for National Day of Prayer. I just really felt like, so I started praying that he would call for National Day of Prayer. So then I heard that a rabbi passed him a note, you know, got a note to him, and said, call for a National Day of Prayer, and, you know, this plague will be minimized, or whatever. I didn't read his note, like, you need to do this. And what happens is, you know, when, let's say that the devil wants to come and kill, steal, and destroy, so when that begins to happen, yet the leader calls, that's why it's important to have leaders that pray. When they come in, what they're doing is they're starting a spiritual war, a spiritual battle in the spiritual realm. And so now it's a fight between, you know, healing or death and destruction kind of thing, you know, and we need, you know, so we need everybody to pray and not forget that, not forsake that, especially, you know, we're speaking to Yamhill County. You know, let's try to minimize this in Yamhill County by being a prayerful people. Even if you're a Democrat, liberal, you know, you don't normally watch, or you're just watching, or what. You know what? God loves you. God loves everybody here. He loves Democrats and Republicans and Independents, and you know, each and every. Yeah. You know, we can all pray and we can all seek the face of God.
Yeah.
And He'll heal our land. That's a promise.
Yes.
So yeah.
So. National Day of Prayer, and you know, we're gonna, you know, like you say, bring it down to the local level, and you know, I think if you're looking for things to do, and maybe you're not the prayerful type person, you're more of an action or a doer, you know, go out into the community, find some groups that may need help that you can volunteer for, you know, to bring meals to elderly, things like this that are shut-ins, the homeless population, whatever we can do to you know, mitigate what's going on, and also still show that love and compassion for within our community for people.
And that is a good segue too. So we're here in Lafayette right now, 392 3rd Street, right on Highway 99 in Lafayette. And I have a little area outside where you could put food if you have extra food. I'm getting less and less food here. It's just something I leave out, you know, so people who, whether they're homeless or they're just short of cash, or there's been so many different types of people that have been taken advantage, but I don't even need to be open. You can just come out and throw the things on the shelf, and then people come and take it. And so that's something that I would appreciate. I know I know the people would appreciate it. So anything else?
No,
something's on your mind.
I think
here?
You know, like you say, the rest of this, you know, we've, like you say, we've kind of entered into this unprecedented time. We do still have an election on May 19th.
Yep.
So there might be some different ways people are campaigning out and about. Probably won't see many people knocking on your door or hanging flyers on your door. So you may actually receive them through the mail, may get telephone calls, things like that, more so I would say be mindful. Try to be as connected as you can in these times, especially through the internet. You know, seek out the party, you know, go to our website or our Facebook page so that we can relay some of that information to you. A lot of candidates are having almost what you would like online meet and greets, you know,
kinds
of things, you know, so that they might set up a Facebook Live event where people can ask them questions and, you know, things like this. So I think it's important that, you know, like you say, when we're talking about trying to live our lives as normal as possible, there might be some newer ways to do campaigning as part of this process. which may turn out to be something more interesting. You know, mm-hmm. we may discover new and
blessings in disguise.
Yeah, you know, new
there's,
things.
There's
that
always
never
a
believed.
Nugget.
Yeah, yeah.
And a gold nugget yeah. in the worst of things.
So we would just hope that you will soon receive the in a few weeks we'll get the voter's guide and like I say we'll be able to maybe hopefully reaching people and getting Republicans elected on May 19th.
Thanks. So I just have a couple things here I want to address. First thing is, yeah, we need to do what we can do, and obviously getting involved in politics or even being somebody that calls people on the phone might actually give you something to do to get your attention away from, not having a job or whatever, the case. So here at the shop here in Lafayette, there's different things I do. One thing I do that because I deeply believe in it, and it's less about money. Actually, it's about paying my rent, I guess. That's about as little money as I make with it. But it's about health. And so, once again, it's if you've looked into nanosilver, that a lot of people vouch for it. It's not FDA approved, so I can just give my testimonies. It's helped in a lot of, infections, and it kills 99% of viruses, bacteria, and fungus. Those are some things that have been proven. But I can't recommend it for the virus. Here's what I'll say. I'll say that me and my family are taking it consistently. And I like this gel. It's a nano gel, and it's for cleaning the hands. I use it on my face, on my hair, and everything. So, these are products I used even before this all happened. And then we have the lozenges that, you put in your mouth that has silver in it. So, that's what my family's doing. And there's been people stopping by here that ask about it. And again, I am not a doctor, but I do talk about what I've heard some of the doctors talk about. So if you want any of that information, if you want that extra confidence of security, that's a good way to go. And next and lastly, I'm going to play a song that's been going on in my head. It's been a real comfort for me, so I hope it's a comfort for you. So enjoy this song, and thanks for tuning in. Have a good week. Be encouraged. Bye-bye. Those trophies could not equal to the grave.
Inspiration, arts and crafts,
health and wellness,
communication and information.
We're here to encourage and inspire you.
You have a gift? We know you do.
And so do we.
Whether you come in to look by or want to promote your gift, we invite you to come in because when we're working together, we can accomplish great things.